There's been tremendous interest in recent years in better treating root canal systems. The secret to treating root canal systems is shaping canals. It allows a reservoir of irrigant to be actively displaced so it can penetrate, circulate, and digest tissue in the areas of the system where our files never reach. In fact, if we can remove all the tissue, the substrates, and bacteria when present, then it is very easy to mold a thermosoftened material to pick up and replicate this anatomy. In this technique, we would fit a master cone. System-based endodontics means pretty much if you finish with a particular finishing file, you'll use the matching gutta percha point. The cone is fit in a wet canal to the full working length, which is the radiographic terminus, recognizing the cone is minutely long. The cone is then adjusted and trimmed back based on paper point drying techniques. That part of the paper point that is consistently dry represents that part of the paper point that is inside the canal. The part of the paper point that spots or that is consistently wet is beyond the physiologic terminus. In this method of obturation, it's critical to pre-fit our pluggers. Always choose the largest plugger that fits loosely over a range of a few millimeters in the coronal 1/3. Select a smaller diameter plugger that will work in the middle 1/3 passively and not restricted by unyielding dentinal walls. Finally, the goal is to fit a smaller plugger that can fit within 5 millimeters of the working length. The canal is dried, sealer is picked up on the master cone, and the cone is teased to place. You can use an appropriate heat source to sear off the non-useful butt end of the cone. Notice the 5 millimeter heat wave that is moving through the master cone. Thermosoftened gutta percha has compaction potential. Using the pre-fit plugger, we can step the plugger methodically around the circumference of the canal, scraping all the gutta percha off the lateral walls and ending with it level. A sustained press then will create a wave of condensation. A wave of condensation was defined by Schilder as simply filling the canal laterally and in depth over a range of a few millimeters. This would conclude the first heating and compaction cycle. We would go in with the heat instrument, activate, and plunge. Plunge about 3 to 4 millimeters into the coronal most aspect of the gutta percha. Release the activating cuff, let the instrument cool, and remove a bite of thermosoftened gutta percha. Two important events have occurred. One, we got another 5 millimeter heat wave through the gutta percha, and by removing a bite, we can now use a smaller pre-fit plugger that can work deeper within the root canal system. Again, step the plugger around the lateral aspects of the wall, level off the gutta percha, and a sustained press of 5 seconds again delivers gutta percha laterally and in depth over a range of a few millimeters. This would represent the second wave of condensation. The heat transfer unit is reintroduced, it's activated, and it plunges again about 3 to 4 millimeters into the coronal most part of the gutta percha. By deactivating the cuff, the instrument cools, and upon removing the instrument, you will note a bite of thermosoftened gutta percha on its distal end. By removing a bite of thermosoftened gutta percha, we notice the same two advantages. We have another heat wave, and in this instance to the terminus of the cone, and then the smallest plugger can be used to mold and adapt the thermosoftened rubber into the apical 1/3 intaglio. We must press on the material for 10 seconds to offset shrinkage. You can begin to see that thermosoftened gutta percha readily moves into available space. So through a series of heatings and compactions, you can begin to see how gutta percha moves into the lateral anatomy. So of course in front of the gutta percha would typically be sealer, and you would see the characteristic Schilder puff, as it's called, on the external root surface associated with the various portals of exit. This would conclude the downpack, and we would now be ready to backpack the canal. We can use the calamus flow device. Use the 23 gauge needle, it's quite warm. Place the warm needle on the top of the previously established core and re-thermosoften the top 2 millimeters. We can now squirt in a little aliquot of thermosoftened gutta percha. We remove the cannula, and again, using the pluggers from small to big, we can step the pluggers circumferentially around the canal, and a sustained press for 5 seconds will mold the previously squirted gutta percha and will get cohesion with the core that was established on the downpack. And through a series of dispensing gutta percha and compaction and dispensing and compacting, we can backpack the canal optimally to the level of the crest of bone. Obviously, if prosthetic dentistry dictates, we could stop the backpack at any point to facilitate placing a post. So when you look at the potential of a warm gutta percha technique, you can see in this 28-year recall that this is the lone palatal root, and this is a 6-unit splint. In this palatal root, which is the pier abutment, notice the deep bifidity, the loop, and the crestal portal of exit. Great endodontics is the foundation for perioprosthetics and long-term success. Let's review why there's a rationale for warm gutta percha. First of all, we're dealing with root canal systems, so it would be wise to move sealer or gutta percha or other materials that are emerging into all aspects of the root canal anatomy. We would fit a master cone to the radiographic terminus. The cone would be cut back according to paper point drawing techniques. It's important to pre-select pluggers so we know when we're pressing on gutta percha, we're never pressing on unyielding dentinal walls. Through a series of heatings and condensations, we can downpack the master cone and deform it into the apical 1/3 through heating and pressure. The downpack is followed by backpacking, and we could stop the backpack at any level to facilitate restorative dentistry. I have just described one of the most powerful methods to fill a root canal system. This was first described in 1967 in Dental Clinics of North America by Dr. Herb Schilder. The only difference between now and then is the technology, and the technology has allowed any dentist who is remotely interested in filling root canal systems to consistently accomplish this goal.